Operational amplifiers are amazing pieces of technology. They were developed back in the era of tube technology. Remember, this is before computers were really a thing. The pioneers of electrical and electronic engineering have always blown me away. The level of focus and talent required to invent any of these devices is impressive. But to take several poorly performing components and put them together in such a way that they behave as an almost ideal system takes a level of insight that few have today. While the ideal approximation for operational amplifiers serves well, there are some limitations to their application. In looking at the frequency response of active filters using op-amps, we have found at least one of these limitations. When we first looked at operational amplifiers, I made the case that we can treat them as ideal amplifiers. This is true as long as we use the amplifier within a certain range of signals and conditions. That is pretty good news. What I think is even better news is that when we step outside of that certain range, as long as we know how we have stepped outside of it, we do not have to throw out everything and start over. This is quite often our approach to dealing with non-idealities. We find an ideal solution and then we tweak it in order to accommodate the non-ideal behavior. If we look at the basic assumptions we make when analyzing ideal operational amplifiers, we can trace each of them back to a property of the amplifier. When we say there is no voltage difference between the input terminals, that is because we approximate the amplifier to have an infinite open loop gain. When we say no current enters the input terminals of the operational amplifier, that is because we approximate the input resistance to be infinite. And when we say the output current of the operational amplifier can be anything, that is because we approximate the output resistance to be zero. When we have to make an adjustment to the ideal model, it is helpful to remember the Thevenin equivalent of the op-amp. This can help us to remember both the ideal model and the reason for the assumptions. It is the Thevenin equivalent input resistance that is responsible for the input current being zero. If we need to account for currents at the input terminals, we simply need to make the resistance finite. If we need to limit the output current of the operational amplifier, we need to increase the output resistance above zero. And if we need to model a voltage difference at the inputs, we adjust the gain of the amplifier to a finite value. In order to look at the frequency response, we are going to look at the open loop gain of the amplifier. We're still assuming the input resistance is infinite and the output resistance is zero. That means we will have no current at the input terminals, and the output current will be whatever it needs to be to make the circuit work. Something we may notice is that if the output resistance of the amplifier is zero, the output voltage will be equal to the output of the dependent source. This will help us analyze the behavior of the circuit with a finite open loop gain. In looking at the circuit, we notice that the non-inverting input of the amplifier is grounded. That makes V2 equal to zero. With the voltage of the non-inverting terminal being equal to zero, we can write the voltage of the inverting terminal in terms of the output voltage and the open loop gain of the amplifier. So with V1 being equal to negative Vout over the open loop gain, we can define currents and write a node equation at the inverting terminal. The current through R1 enters the node and is equal to the input voltage minus the negative output voltage divided by the open loop gain, all divided by R1. The current that leaves the node is negative Vout over the open loop gain minus the output voltage divided by R2. We can multiply through this equation by R2 and then gather the terms of Vout on the right side of the equation. Factoring Vout, the equation can be solved for the ratio of Vout to Vin. The equation that we are left with has some behavior that we might expect. For example, if the open loop gain goes to infinity, the non-ideal term becomes zero. So the output of the amplifier with respect to the input simply becomes the negative ratio of the resistors. That is the ideal output of an inverting operational amplifier. What does this have to do with the frequency response? If you take a look back to the previous video, or if you look at the frequency response of anything but the simplest circuits, it does not take many energy storage devices for the transfer function of the circuit to become incredibly complex. The operational amplifier is a complicated arrangement of individual components. The inside of a 741 op-amp might look something like this. Those strange symbols with the circles around them are bipolar junction transistors. There are two different types of transistors in the circuit along with various other components. The high frequency model of a bipolar junction transistor looks something like this. I could add some components to this model, but this one is sufficient for demonstrating my point. Each of the transistors in that circuit can be modeled with at least two capacitors. Each of those capacitors will have a frequency dependent term. Those terms will not be the same, as the behavior will be dependent upon the total equivalent resistance experienced or encountered by each particular capacitor. That makes for a lot of frequency dependent terms. But one of the main obstacles that needs to be overcome when designing an operational amplifier is that of stability. That is why it's necessary to provide negative feedback in an operational amplifier circuit. With a very high gain, and with the presence of so many frequency-dependent components, a simple way to control the frequency behavior of the entire amplifier is to set it up so there is a dominant corner frequency that occurs at a very low frequency. In this way, the high gain characteristics are greatly reduced before we get to the complicated frequency response. Here I have graphed the minimum open loop gain for a 741 op amp. The dominant low frequency corner or dominant pole causes the open loop gain to begin decreasing at angular frequencies in the neighborhood of 100 radians per second. You might also notice that in this case, by the time our frequency is 2 megaradians per second, the gain is 0 decibels. This frequency is called the unity gain frequency because the gain at that frequency is 1 volt per volt. Now, I am using the worst case parameters for the 741. The actual device performance will usually be a little better than this. Let us look at the numbers as they were given. Using 20 volts per millivolt as the open loop DC gain and 100 radians per second as the dominant corner frequency of the amplifier, we can look at the transfer function of an inverting amplifier with a gain of 5 volts per volt. I thought it would be a little too messy to substitute A of J omega into the transfer function, so I will leave them separate. We can see that at low frequency we have a gain of 5 volts per volt, which corresponds to 13.98 decibels. The amplifier behaves in an ideal way into the kiloradians per second range. At 330 kiloradians per second, we hit our 3 dB point, also called the half power frequency. And at a frequency of 1.63 megaradians per second, the gain has dropped to 1 volt per volt. With the exception of the falloff at the higher frequencies, the circuit still behaves ideally. Note that as we increase the gain of the amplifier circuit, it will increase the non-ideal term in the transfer function. So when the circuit should have a gain of 50 volts per volt, it is slightly below that at 49.9 volts per volt, or 33.96 decibels. The half power frequency is now 39.2 kiloradians per second. That is smaller than the previous circuit. The frequency response and the gain of the amplifier circuit are coupled. The more gain we try to get out of the circuit, the smaller the range of frequencies over which the circuit will function. There is an increase in the unity gain frequency to 1.96 megaradians per second. We'll have to keep an eye on that. If the gain is increased by another factor of 10, the result deviates from the ideal even more. The gain of the circuit should be 500 volts per volt, but we see that it is 488 volts per volt, or 53.77 decibels. The half power frequency has dropped to 4.082 kiloradians per second. That is just under 650 Hz. If I were to filter out everything over 650 Hz from my speech,
the result would be a very degraded audio signal.
As for the unity gain frequency, we see it is 2 megaradians per second, which, if you remember, was the unity gain frequency of the operational amplifier itself. To be ridiculous, what if we tried to make the gain of the inverting amplifier equal to the open loop gain of the op amp itself? First, we will note that the actual gain of the amplifier is less than half the expected output. The half power frequency has dropped all the way to 200 radians per second. That corresponds to about 32 Hz. If this were an audio amplifier, it would essentially filter out any audible sound. The unity gain frequency is still 2 megaradians per second. So we see the price of stability. In order to get an operational amplifier to behave ideally over any range, we have to limit the frequency response of the op amp itself. That is accomplished internally in the operational amplifier by having a dominant low frequency corner. We can account for this by adjusting the open loop gain of the operational amplifier and adding in a frequency dependence. In this video, we started by analyzing the effect of a finite open loop gain and then adjusted the open loop gain based on frequency. The examples demonstrated the more we try to get out of an operational amplifier, the less ideally it will behave. This is generally true. If we push the limits of any device, we will see more non-ideal behavior. We also saw the gain of the operational amplifier circuit is coupled with the frequency response. The more gain we try to get out of the operational amplifier, the smaller the range of frequencies over which it will amplify. That's all for today. Go out and make it a great one.